Hong Kong is a kind of miracle. Over the last centuries, Hong Kong started from a small village and now becomes to be one of the top major cities in the world and also one of the major financial centers around the world. It's also a stepping stone for people to do business with China and through China to the world. This book is a very particular book. We call the major happening in Hong Kong over the last centuries. I hope we can use this book to introduce to our friends around the world, let them know more about Hong Kong, and they are always welcome to come to Hong Kong and use Hong Kong as a gateway to the world. Well, I would like to tell you about myself. I am a locally born Chinese. Actually, I was born in 1949. And as most of the young people during those time, we all grew up from very poor family. And the chance for us to receive education is not good. But fortunately, I'm the youngest in the family, so I still have the chance to receive primary education, secondary education, and university education in Hong Kong. So that's kind of lucky. But I'd like to let people know that during those days, for Chinese people who study in the secondary school, Chinese secondary school, they don't have a chance to get into the university because University of Hong Kong only accept, I must emphasize, English school students during those days. And fortunately, in early 60s, a group of people proposed that we should give these students a chance to receive their tertiary education in Hong Kong. And then a committee set up by the government to establish the Chinese University of Hong Kong. In 1963, finally, the university was established. And I fortunately had the chance to get into this university to finish my 4 years university education. And the good thing about the university, the education in Hong Kong is we have a lot of chance to study, not only in your major subject, but through a lot of activities in the university. We learn a lot of other things, including, for example, I was the editor of the student newspaper. Through that, I learned a lot. Also, we had the chance to do a lot of things to care about what is happening in the society. For example, during my second year, I had a chance to participate in a student movement organized by the Federation of Hong Kong Students in 1968. Well, that one is a very meaningful student movement. We fight for Chinese as the official language in Hong Kong. Because before that, the only official language in Hong Kong was English. So after that movement, we have been successful to convince the government to make Hong Kong a bilingual city. Since then, both English and Chinese becomes to be Hong Kong's official language. That's the kind of movement that we have participated. And also, in the next year, of course, we have some other things like Delhi Thai, that kind of thing. But that's most of the university students will do that kind of thing. But we have not forgot about studying. We all learn very hard, work very hard, and study very hard. And we have been fortunate enough during that kind of, that period of time, Hong Kong's economy has been booming. So when we graduate from the university, it's not very difficult for us to find a job. And after I graduate, I have been very lucky. 3 jobs are waiting for me. And I chose my first job as an assistant secretary, although I stayed there only for less than 2 years. But I have been very lucky to participate in a very major event. 10 Hong Kong major business associations, they joined together to fight with the government talking about the crown rent reassessment issue. And I was the assistant secretary of these 10 groups. And finally, it has been successful, and they fight and they got what they want from the Hong Kong government. And then, after 2 years, I resigned from the association and start to join the real business in Hong Kong. I participate into the major manufacturing factory in Hong Kong called Hong Kong Spinners Limited, which is a factory which at that time is the largest factory in Hong Kong. They make yarn and fabric. My position there was the marketing manager selling yarn and fabric. Again, I've been very lucky because textile was Hong Kong's very important industry, and the yarn and fabric made in Hong Kong is very easy for us to sell to the world. So it's not very difficult for me to do this job. Now, talking about this textile factory, in those days, Hong Kong's economy just started to take off. And this kind of industry, technology, money, they were brought in by a group of very, very experienced entrepreneur from the mainland China after 1949. There were, if I remember correctly, there were a total of 43 textile factories in Hong Kong. Most of them come from the Shanghai area, and some of them come from Chuzhou, and they have become very, very important backbone of the Hong Kong economy, Hong Kong manufacturing industry. Now, because of that, you know, Hong Kong was only a very small city. With that kind of product, we have to find a way to sell the product, and therefore export is very important. With that kind of thinking in mind, the four major manufacturing and business association in Hong Kong joined together and discussed with the government and negotiated that we should or we might need to have trade organizations organized by the Hong Kong government to help Hong Kong business people to promote their external trade. With that kind of thinking in mind, they talking about the establishment of something like JECTO, the Japan Trade Organization in Hong Kong, to help Hong Kong business people to promote export. That's the result that an organization called Hong Kong Trade Development Council was established. That was, if I remember correctly, that was in 1962. The first office was located in Ocean Center. That organization, after they established, very soon, it becomes to be one of the very and successful and important trade promotion organizations in the world. Apart from textile industry, in fact, in those days, there are still some other very important industry at that time that include toy, plastic flowers, transistor radio, jeans, etc. And not too many people know, because of the export of Hong Kong product, attract people to know more about Hong Kong. And at that time, people from Hollywood also pay attention to Hong Kong. And they start to send their crew to come to Hong Kong to produce the Hollywood film in Hong Kong, such as the World of Lan Chi Kwan, etc. Well, that kind of very historical film even up to now, people still like to repeat and repeat to review that kind of film. Although I enjoy my time with the Hong Kong Spinners Limited, unfortunately, because in Hong Kong during the 70s, the production cost, I mean the manufacturing cost, in Hong Kong is getting higher and higher. As business people, they have to care about this, and therefore they decided to cease their business and move their factory to Southeast Asia country, to Africa, etc. Hong Kong Spinners Limited decided to move their factory to Seoul, and because of my family reason, I decided not to follow them to move to Indonesia. And therefore I start to change my career. And the next one, fortunately, the career that I like most during my career time, that's the Hong Kong Trade Development Council. I joined the council in 1976 as a trade advisor, and my first assignment was with the Comic Contest. Comic Con was the area, now we call it the Eastern Europe. And I started with this in 1976. And after 2 years, the council find out that the market in the Latin America has been opened up. And therefore they decided to open another office in Panama. Well, before that, let me touch about Hong Kong Trade Development Council. When they opened in 1962, they already have 4 overseas offices. The original 4, if I remember correctly, that was in London, in New York, in Tokyo, and in Toronto. And of course, during the 70s, the TDC's overseas office has been increased to, I think it's around 13 or 14 offices around the world. And Panama was one of the latest in the late 70s. And I was posted to Panama in 1979, overseeing the whole Latin American market, including Central America and South America. Why Panama? Because Panama is always the financial centers in that region, And people in South America, when they want to purchase Hong Kong product, they have to come to Panama, bring their cash to the Kowloon Free Zone to buy the product and ship to South America. And therefore, Hong Kong Trade Development Council decided to open the office in Panama. I consider it was a very good move. Not very long. I stayed in Panama for only 2 years, but I actually learned a lot on how to do business with the Latin American people. I returned to Hong Kong in 1982, and then at that time, Hong Kong and is entering into another period, another very important era, because at that time, China and Britain is talking about the future of Hong Kong. When Margaret Thatcher went to Beijing and talked to Deng Xiaoping, talking about the timeline for Hong Kong's return to China, it had been decided in 1982, Hong Kong had to be returned to China in 1997. And therefore, Hong Kong Trade Development Council decided that it's about time for Hong Kong to get in touch with the mainland. And therefore, my new position in the council becomes to be the manager taking care about the Greater China area. In 1982, Hong Kong Trade Development Council decided to organize the first ever high-level Hong Kong business delegation to Beijing, Shanghai, and Guangzhou, which include most of the CEO of Hong Kong's major organizations, such as Hong Kong Bank, Standard Chartered Bank, Jardine Matheson, etc., etc. And that was the first ever Hong Kong delegation. I still have the brochure here. about that delegation. We went to Beijing, and we have been received by the top level government official in Zhongnanhai. We were actually received by Mr. Xi Jinping's father, Mr. Xi Zhongxun, and that was a historical visit. And 2 years later, the council decided to open the first office in Beijing, and I was assigned as the first chief representative to Beijing in 1984 and start to open TDC's office. And in the meantime, in 1984, Hong Kong Trade Development Council organized the first Hong Kong exhibition in China. It was a machinery exhibition in Guangzhou. That was in 1984. And then in 1985, the second Hong Kong exhibition was organized by TDC in Shanghai. And in the meantime, another high-level delegation has been organized by the Hong Kong Trade Development Council to visit Shanghai in 1985. And this is the brochure of that delegation. It was very, very successful. And at that time, although TDC was not recognized as a government body, but because China at the same time is trying to learn how to promote international trade, and therefore Hong Kong Trade Development Council's experience has been very valuable to China, and therefore they welcome TDC to open office in Beijing in China, and we work together and learn together on how to do the international trade promotion. I work in TDC for actually a total of 14 years, and I went to Beijing in 1984, start to establish the Hong Kong Trade Development Council's first office in Beijing. I stayed in Beijing until 1987, and actually during those 4 or 5 years, I've been doing a lot of things. Let me highlight two things. The first thing I find it very interesting was we helped China to organize the first team of fashion show model. The reason was in 1985, the Hong Kong Trade Development Council wanted to recruit a few fashion show models from mainland China to attend our ready-to-wear and annual ready-to-wear festival in Hong Kong. And I was successfully organized that fashion show team for China and of course for TDC as well. This is one thing, I find it very interesting. The other thing, I have been very proud of myself that I have do something good for China, because at that time there were a total of 14 major universities in China. They do a lot of research, very, very good quality research. But unfortunately, the research result, after they complete, they have no way to get this research result to turn into actual manufacturing products in mainland China. And therefore, I suggest to the head office in Hong Kong, let us organize an exhibition talking about to transfer the research result of mainland China's major universities so that the Hong Kong manufacturers can share that result and upgrade Hong Kong's product. And therefore, in early 1986, we organized the first mainland China University Research Result Exhibition in Hong Kong. It was a very, very successful one. I stayed in Beijing for a total of 5 years and returned to Hong Kong in 1987. In 1987, actually, before I returned, I also opened the Shanghai office, and then I come back. After I come back, I resigned from TDC and joined one of the major investment banks in Hong Kong to manage the first ever China fund in the world with the target of mainland China as the target investment location. That was a pioneer China fund in the world. The fund size was small, but the shareholders were very important. That include IFC, that include major banks in UK such as Robert Fleming, in Hong Kong Jardine Fleming, and three insurance companies in United States as the shareholder, also the Kuwaiti Investment Authority as the shareholders. Now, at that time, actually it was a very, very important pilot project. Because, why I say that? Because in China, in those days, China was not ready for financial investment. They even don't understand what's financial investment. So we have to tell people in China, tell the manufacturer in China, tell the factory in China who we are, why we are doing this, and how we are going to proceed with this. So this is not an easy task. And my boss actually in Jardine Fleming told me that try your best, even if it is a failure project, it's okay, because we just want to learn. We just want to see how to do direct investment in China. It was not a totally successful project, but I think it bring into China our knowledge about what is financial investment. And since then, China gradually also learned how to do this. And then in 1989, I was invited by the Hong Kong Trade Development Council to return to the council because they have a vacancy in Toronto. They need somebody to fill out the office. So I was invited to return and then becomes to be the director of Canada of TDC based in Toronto. I stayed there for 3 years. And in that 3 years, I actually don't need to promote a lot of Hong Kong export to Canada because it was already doing very well. So I used that as a vehicle to promote Hong Kong as a gateway to the world, Hong Kong as a gateway to mainland China. And it was also very, very successful. In 1992, I returned to Hong Kong from Toronto at the invitation of another investment bank, Climate Benson, to manage another China fund called China Investment and Development Fund, which is a bigger size fund. And that time is the mid of 1992. And then I was invited by another investment bank based in the one based in Boston called Advent International. They established a Hong Kong Greater China office, and I was appointed as the managing director of the fund. Also, they used the fund to make investment in mainland China. Also, we make investment in Taiwan and Hong Kong as well, but mostly still in China. Until I do this kind of investment activities until the year of almost a year of 2000. And look back, in total, I managed three China funds. I have made a total of 47 investments in China. One half of that, I consider it was successful, make money, and one half of that was fail. But I find it very, very interesting and very happy that I did this, because that on one hand, I learned a lot. On the other hand, China from that kind of activities also learned how to do investment fund. And today we can see in China, they already have a lot of similar kind of investment fund, and they have been doing in a very mature manner already this day. In the year of 2000, I was invited by one of my very best friends to prepare for the participation in the Shanghai Expo, which would be opened in the year of 2010. My friend is the organizer of the World Trade Center Organization Pavilion in the Shanghai Expo, and I was invited to participate in making the design to organized the Hong Kong student to participate in the pavilion. Also, we try to invite some volunteer from the universities in Shanghai to work together on this Hong Kong, on this World Trade Center Organization Pavilion. It was opened in 2010, and I was invited to act as the deputy pavilion director of the pavilion. Look back, we had invited a total of 40 Hong Kong students from several universities to work together, and now, after 10 years, these 40 students has been very mature now, and they are lawyer, they are doctor, they are in their own, they have their own business, or even they work as a police supervisor in Hong Kong today. So we think this is was a very meaningful activities in my life, in my lifetime. Let me sidetrack a little bit. Apart from business, I actually enjoy, although I study accounting, but I also like a lot about Chinese arts, music, etc. I do calligraphy. Now, let me show you the pavilion, the World Trade Center Organization Pavilion here. The name Chinese was written by me, and I was very proud of that, actually, yeah. I resigned from the all kind of investment job in the year of 2000. And since then, I was working on my own, acting as a consultant, advising people on doing the IPO listing, advising people to how to do business with China, and as consultant for a few companies. Now I'm independent director of two Hong Kong listed company, and also I start to participate in Hong Kong's education field, including a secondary school. I act as an SMC member, and I also participate in the kindergarten business, which I think is very important because Hong Kong, we need the right direction for the education, which I would like to do it towards this direction. And today, look back, Hong Kong, although in the last 2 years, we have went through some, turbulence, but in fact, the basic situation in Hong Kong has not been changed. Hong Kong still the world's important financial center. Because Hong Kong is very close to China, and with the backup of China, and also we have a number of years of experience in doing business with the world. And as a financial center, Hong Kong has been very famous for a long time. And all of these facts are still existing. And therefore, I have a very, very good confidence that Hong Kong in the future still a very important cities in the world. So all of my friends around the world, you are welcome to come to Hong Kong and take a look by yourself, and use Hong Kong as a base to go into mainland China, the largest market in the world, and also use Hong Kong as a base to do business in the rest of the world.